at Sikkim365.com.
All right, here we go. 3 o'clock hour. Taylor Young at the bottom of the hour. Tari Cummings, the newest addition to women's basketball staff, will join us at 4. Then also today at 4:30, Jeremy Hefner, plus much more. John Daniels at 5:30. Craig Smoak on Skype today. Paul Catalina, David Smoak, we're in studio here on Sikkim 365 Radio. Colt Barber in what is a constant, I mean, it's almost like a laundromat of clothing going inside all the washers and dryers. There's so much content being put in the premium section, pinned or not, and I know you can join it to be a part of it. And on occasion, there's so much in there. We want to share some of it with you, but also we'd love for you to become a premium member. Colt, you dropped a bunch of nuggets today in football. Obviously, to me, the one that is most important, and I've been told this as well, they need and they want to get some sort of transfer offensive lineman who's played college football somewhere. How much of a story will that be if they can get the kid from Buffalo?
Yeah, I mean, that's huge. And you, excuse me, you look at who they have targeted and where they have ended up, and you don't want to say they're striking out on their top targets. Like, you don't know. We can talk to as many people as we want to. I think there's been some disappointment with guys that they have missed. But when you look at the Nowitzki, I believe is how you pronounce his name, he's a center for Buffalo. He's been in the portal, and he's getting attention from everywhere. And I think that they have all along have wanted him. And so you look at a guy like that, and you have Grant Miller and you have Xavier Newman. Well, at this point, you bring in who you can bring in, and if they're one of the best players, they're going to play. They're going to find a position for them to play. So maybe it's at one of the guard positions. Xavier Newman plays guard. Maybe Grant Miller plays guard. I think that they're just going to attempt to stockpile talent. And when you say you bring in one, you bring in one, but you bring in two or three, you know, including Grant Miller, who would be the initial one. So maybe they end up with three transfer offensive linemen and then let the chips fall where they may, because they have to upgrade the offensive line talent. And the offense will be what it is, or it will have a kind of a ceiling on it until that offensive line can improve, regardless of who the quarterback is. So, getting one player in is a big deal. Getting one or two more at this point in the process going into the summer and fall camp is a major step forward. And you know what they've built and continue to build on defense. I think that's going to be the strength of the team. If they can get an offensive line that can give them a consistent running game, this team can be really dangerous. And maybe you don't expect to go out and compete for a Big 12 championship, but I think that you can be consistently competing in every single game if you can improve that offensive line to the point where the offense is consistent.
Colt, if say they do get the kid from Buffalo, would the third one maybe be a JUCO?
Yeah, I mean, the JUCO is such a tough situation this year because you have so many guys that just like the FCS that just got through playing in a spring season technically. Some guys that didn't play. You're looking at film that's relatively new. You're evaluating guys that are relatively new. I think if someone pops up that they feel like can contribute for multiple years, I think you have to take him, especially if they want to come. Now, it's kind of tricky because a transfer prospect like the Buffalo prospect or Grant Miller have 1 year, maybe 2 years because of COVID, and that's a good thing. You can kind of process them through the system. You don't want to take a junior college guy that potentially has 3 years left that could take up a scholarship when they don't end up competing for a starting position. Junior college transfers are always tricky because you just don't know how well they're going to contribute at the next level. Whereas a guy like Grant Miller, he has a baseline. He played in the SEC. He started for an SEC team, albeit it was with Vanderbilt, who's not relatively strong. But you just have to be careful with junior college guys. But I think if an offensive tackle pops up where they really need some help, I think it makes sense to take a risk because they're going to need depth. If it's not this year, it's going to be in the future where guys can develop. And I just don't know if there's one specific one on the radar right now that they're willing to take.
So, Colt, a few years ago, it was, you know, with the offensive line, a lack of bodies. And then Matt Rhule did the best he could to try and get them up scholarship-wise, which they did. So clearly there were some talent misses there. Why is the offensive line still in the shape that it's in your opinion? Is it been more just evaluation misses, hoping guys would pan out that didn't pan out, or is it other factors as well?
Yeah, the three most important things in my mind that I'm looking to, one of them was on your show yesterday, in Eliasa Anderson at Sam Houston. That was a guy that the previous staff felt like was going to contribute. He did contribute early. He was going to contribute a lot. So you have him that leaves and is at Sam Houston. You have Prince Pines that made that in the previous staff. They were expecting him to play a lot moving forward. So they're both out of the program. And then the third one is kind of not as eye-popping as those two departures. But Blake Vettier not taking advantage of a third year. And truthfully, it was just not getting to redshirt one of his first 2 years on campus. That was the key to his development, was being able to get in redshirt, even though they could play four games, redshirt, get that year back, and then play this year and be really productive this year. He never got to do that. So you take those three guys out of the system going into this year, and you're going to have a lot of trouble. Then you can talk about Elijah Hall, who's also at the SEC level now that is playing. There's just, you can't take in a program like Baylor or any program that's not Texas, Texas A&M, Oklahoma, Alabama, you take three guys that you're expecting to contribute over the course of 2 or 3 years and you remove them from the program. Those weren't just guys that they said that they could possibly be something. Those were guys that were already playing. And you take those out and you're in a world of trouble, because you just don't reload that quickly. And Matt Rhule knew that because of the fact that he was recruiting more and more bodies. You just can't reload. You got to develop. And those are three guys that were looked at as being heavily relied upon, not just last year, but this year as well.
All right. So, Cole, question for you. You know, we know what they have in the quarterback room, and it's almost like you wish you could take a little bit of each one of them and make them into one quarterback, but that's not going to happen. Who, in your opinion, based on what you think you'll see defensively with Baylor, under Dave Aranda, under Ron Robertson, Joey McGuire, and all the others, it looks like they're going to be really, really good. I'm not sure if they'll be 2019 good, but they have that opportunity. With that being the case, who's the best fit, in your opinion, to run the offense for Baylor?
Is Grayson in the studio with y'all right now, by any chance?
No, he's not.
Okay. He will battle me tooth and nail on this. And we've had the discussion offline, so I don't mind talking about it. I think it's Gary Bohannon, and I lean that way because if Baylor can't find a running game, and we've seen it back to 2019 when Baylor was successful, they finally found a little bit of running game with the running back, but the primary ability to move the chains was with the quarterback running the football, and that was with Charlie Brewer, who stayed dinged up because he ran the football so much, and Gary Bohannon can run the football, and I know that we question and we have doubts and concerns about his ability to threaten defenses with his arm consistently and manipulate defenses with his arm. Well, what he can do is manipulate defense with legs. We know that 100% sure, know that he can make defenses rely upon him. It's going to make windows a little bit bigger with this offense they're going to be running. We know he can push the ball vertically. Maybe he's not accurate. Maybe he's not as accurate as Jake Cazino, but he can push the ball vertically. So at this point, I have to go with Gary Bohannon because you want to give your defense rest. And if that's one additional first down drive every two drives, that's a big thing for a team last year who consistently could not stay on the field on offense. And as good as that defense was, they got worn down. We saw an Oklahoma State game where it was kind of all came to a head and they just couldn't do anything on either side of the ball because that defense was worn out. And so I think if you put in Gary Bohannon at this point, and you know what his strength is, and you play to that strength, it makes the most sense. Now, Jacob Zeno could go out there, have a great fall camp. The offensive line protects him. He doesn't have to use his legs a lot to make plays, and he becomes a starter. I think he has that potential. I just think for this particular team at this moment, my opinion is Gary Bohannon makes the most sense.
Craig, you got anything?
Colt, I guess running back wise, what do you think of the situation they have right now?
Yeah, you can look at a lot of positions on the field for this team, specifically on defense. I think offensive line, maybe they don't have a lot of talent. We don't know a lot about the talent, but the bodies are there. Receiver, there are bodies there. That running back group, if Squirrel Williams is healthy, which it sounds like he will be for fall camp, I really like the way that group is shaping up. And that's primarily because of Abram Smith. If you go back and watch the BYU offense from last year and the way that those backs ran in that system, and then you go watch the spring game of Abram Smith, it is almost identical to what they did. And kind of believe it or not, the running back there for BYU, was actually a converted linebacker, and he rushed for, I think, 12 or 1,300 yards last year. And it makes a lot. It's a downhill, one cut, runs with power. But he really takes that running back room to a bit more well-rounded group. John Lovett would have been a perfect fit for this room, but I think Abram Smith can provide that same type of style. And then, obviously, you know what you're getting, Tristan Ebner. If Squirrel Williams can be healthy, he's such a lightning bug. Like, he can do so many different things with the football. You just such a good change of pace. Those three, as the top running backs in the room, can do a lot of damage. But once again, it always comes down to the offensive line. How productive can that group be? How consistent and how much can they gel? But you look at Squirrel Williams, how much better that offensive line looked last year whenever he played. That's just a testament to his talent and the way that his style of play. And if he can be healthy, that's a key piece of that offense. He's a lot better than it was last year.
When you can get a freshman that can be good enough to start, it could be in any position, but obviously running back is one who can come in and make a pretty big impact. You've got Ebner, who's seasoned. Obviously, what Abram Smith has brought to the table since, what, 2 or 3 weeks before their spring game. But what about Jordan Jenkins and what he brings? I know that he might need to marinate. He's a big kid. Seems like he would fit in this offensive style with his size and power. You feel like he might get a few looks or not?
Yeah, I think he has to. And the reason that he has to is because he's going to be on the bench and you don't have to be worrying about burning a red shirt. That four game rule for a guy like Jordan Jenkins is massive, because you can say, man, is he ready? We don't know if he's ready, but you have 4 games to find out if he's ready. And that will really depend on fall camp as well. The staff can say he is not ready to do this yet, and we know that he's not. So let's send some reps late in games. But if he comes out in those first 3 non-conference games and gets some carries consistently, they might have that decision to make. Do we play him more than 4? You don't want to waste him too quick. You might still get those carries too quick. But I think that you will know pretty soon if his game will translate. Because that's the biggest question mark, is how does that jump? And obviously, Lindell is not a small school by any means, but the step up in competition is huge. And everyone's curious how he will translate. Well, those, you know, however many touchdowns and yards he had, will that translate to a potential 1,000-yard season at some point in his career at Baylor? It's very possible. We don't know until he gets on the field of how quickly it will do it.
All right. Thank you very much, Colt. Appreciate it. Good stuff in the premium section. We just touched on a couple of things, really. There's a lot of juice in there. Running backs, offensive line, among many things as well, with the quarterback room as well. That's Colt Barber, Sikkim365.com. When we come back, he's now the defensive quality control coach under Seth Luttrell and under Phil Bennett's defense at North Texas, former Baylor all-conference linebacker. Taylor Young, next on Sikkim 365 Radio.
Hey, this is Bryce Petty, former starting quarterback and 2-time Big 12 champion, and I know firsthand the importance of being in top shape.